When people think of Simpsons-related video games, there's usually two major ones that come to mind: the Simpsons arcade game and the Simpsons Hit and Run. That's for good reason. The arcade game is a certified classic, and Hit and Run is an iconic mishmash of Grand Theft Auto's gameplay and the world of Springfield. Yet beyond this pair, most Simpsons games don't really have the best reputation. You'll see occasional mentions of the 2007 game, or the mediocre mobile app, or the dozens of weird cash-ins that were released in the mid-90s and early 2000s, but there's one in particular that is defined solely by its related controversy and lawsuit. It also happens to be the only Simpsons game that I had as a child, which basically introduced me to the series. I'm talking about The Simpsons Road Rage, which released in the holiday of 2001 for the Xbox, GameCube, and PS2. What was it about this game that made it controversial enough to lead to a lawsuit? To find out, we'll have to dive deep into the game's history, its legacy, and the quality of the package itself. Howdy folks, I'm Jenny Geist, and I'm going to see if the bird is the word for this forgotten family racer, or if this licensed tie-in should have just shut up, meh. Wait, shoot. Road Rage was published by Electronic Arts and developed by Radical Entertainment, the same team that would later make Hit and Run in 2003, as well as several other licensed games of varying quality. Their 90s lineup includes infamous names like Mario is Missing, Mario's Time Machine, and a ton of sports titles, but their 2000s lineup includes at least a few notable releases such as Crash Tag Team Racing and, well, Hit and Run itself. Unfortunately, the studio eventually got eaten up by Activision, which resulted in them devolving into another support studio. How shocking. Before we get to the actual game, let's first address the Stampy in the room. Road Rage is pretty much an exact ripoff of Sega's Crazy Taxi series. Not even in the way of this is obviously the same thing but changed at least somewhat, like, say, Mario Kart-inspired clones. This is pretty much the exact same gameplay structure, dumped down a tiny bit and given a yellow coat of paint. And this came out on the GameCube a month after Crazy Taxi did, which is just kind of funny. For those who might not know, Crazy Taxi is a 1999 Sega arcade game that got ported to the Dreamcast 1 year later. This score-focused racer sees players trying to chauffeur as many people as they can, as fast as they can, making as much money as they can, before the timer runs out. Learning the map and mastering the controls will help one avoid all obstacles and find great success, and along the way, different maps, playable characters, and score modifiers will mix things up. Even without those, however, the concept is so simple yet so genius that it remains infinitely fun to this day. Seriously, it is an absolute travesty that Crazy Taxi is not on Switch yet. I would be there day zero. Meanwhile, The Simpsons Road Rage sees players trying to chauffeur as many people as they can, as fast as they can, making as much money as they can before the timer runs out. Learning the map and mastering the controls will help one avoid all obstacles and find great success, and along the way, different maps, playable characters, and score modifiers will mix things up, and in this one you can also run over Grandpa, so maybe this is the better game. Out of all the knockoff games out there, this is definitely one of the more blatant, especially with how little it changes the formula and how close the release was to the thing it's copying. Plus, it's kind of a given that the original will be better than the licensed clone, so on its surface, this release seems a bit redundant. But I digress. Even if Road Rage is completely unoriginal, I do want to give it a fair shot before talking about the legal issues. After all, copying a popular gameplay style, but adding a different tone or flavor to the mix isn't inherently bad. Hit and Run is basically a clone of Grand Theft Auto 3, and that's still a well-liked game. Granted, it does justify itself a little bit more by being a PG take on the genre and introducing a few twists, but again, I digress. Let's finally see what this game is all about. The game begins with Mr. Burns announcing a fleet of nuclear-powered buses that he's releasing onto the streets, and the Simpsons family is pretty concerned by this public health hazard.
Please kill me.
That poor man. I hope someone does kill him.
To combat Burns' reign and make some sweet cash, Homer decides to use his own car as a taxi, creating a safer option that will hopefully drive the nuclear transport out of town. The rest of Springfield soon follows suit while Mr. Burns and Smithers drive around to try and stop the competition. The starting roster is Homer, Bart, Marge, Lisa, and Grandpa, but playing through the main mode can unlock Groundskeeper Willie, Krusty, Apu, Barney, Moe, Otto, Chief Wiggum, Stupid Flanders, Mr. Plow, Reverend Lovejoy, Snake, and Professor Frink. Each character's vehicle is a reference to a different classic season episode, and they all play slightly differently. Homer's family car is a typical all-arounder, Marge's Canyonero is slower but more resilient, Bart's honor roller is flighty and hard to control, and Lisa's Lugtaurus is light and nimble. With this variation, some vehicles do end up being objectively better than others. Willie's tractor is slow and basically useless, Barney's Plow King is practically a tank, and Otto's school bus obviously has some trouble making tight turns. Meanwhile, Lisa's Lugtaurus is wonderfully versatile, and Professor Frink's hover car is objectively the fastest and most useful vehicle in the game. The imbalance is odd, but considering this is just a TV show tie-in game, I'll give it a pass. If anyone wants to get into competitive play though, here's my tier list. I'm currently working on a campaign to get Professor Frink banned, so please sign my change.org petition. Pass it around! The roster only contains a fraction of Springfield's population, but dozens of other recurring characters can appear as possible passengers, such as Principal Skinner, Comic Book Guy, Jasper, Mrs. Krabappel, and more. Every single character is played by their original voice actor with brand new lines, including all six main cast members, Pamela Hayden, and even the late Marsha Wallace. The dialogue certainly isn't top-tier Simpsons material, this did come out alongside Season 13 after all, but as far as one-liners in a licensed game go, there's quite a few chuckle-worthy gags.
Ah, I'm coming to join you, Maud!
God, that's dark. Predictably, a game like this does run into the issue of repetitive voice clips, however. There's only so many NPCs in the game, and each one only has so many canned phrases. A few characters do have specialized dialogue for picking each other up, but even those all get heard fairly quickly. After a few hours, you'll probably have heard all the lines dozens of times, and most of them get very old.
Simpson House, please. I've got some looting to do.
Do you have any barf bags?
This repetition wouldn't be so bad if the unlock process didn't force you to play so much to get everything. For reference, reaching a certain cash milestone allows one to unlock another starting area or another playable character. Most people will opt for unlocking the other five areas first for maximum variety, but then to unlock the other characters, one has to keep going and going to reach these continually increasing goals, at a certain point needing to make $100,000 to unlock each character. It's not like there's many other modes to add a variety either. There's Sunday Drive mode, which is just scoreless free play, and Mission mode, which has 10 relatively easy missions that either fall into knock down X number of things within X seconds, or chauffeur this passenger while avoiding Mr. Burns. Beyond that, all there is to do is to hit the arcade grind, which just feels like an inorganic way of bolstering the game's content. It's okay for an arcade game to just be an arcade game, so forcing players to go at it for at least 10 hours to unlock every character feels like an obnoxious hurdle to experiencing all the content. That's more than enough about the character roster, though. The maps themselves are much more important in a game like this, and as one would expect, they are chock full of Simpsons references. There are six separate neighborhoods, including Evergreen Terrace, the Entertainment District, Springfield Dam, the Nuclear Power Plant, Downtown, and Springfield Mountain. Almost every single location in each of these maps is a reference to a classic Simpsons gag, whether it be a banner for Planet of the Apes the musical, or a ramp based off of the escalator to nowhere. You can drop people off at the Maison Derrière, the Truckosaurus Stadium, or the Giant's Toilet from a random one-off joke in a crappy Season 10 episode. The results screen after each match is even read by
Mr. Black.
Let's see what rating
Mr. Black
gives us.
Hey, your rating is
insane.
But of course, fan service does not necessarily translate into good level design, and yeah, the maps here are a pretty mixed bag. The first two areas, Evergreen Terrace and the Entertainment District, are fine. There's no real major issues with them. One is a simple neighborhood area, and one is a simple city area. Solid B+ effort. The rest of the maps, though... Springfield Dam is too spread out, the roads are claustrophobic, and the drop-off locations are not that varied. The nuclear power plant has a bizarre design, with locations being split across two far apart sections, meaning each drive will either be really long or really short. Springfield Mountain has a similar issue to Springfield Dam, but is slightly less problematic, and the downtown area is pretty decent but can cause some chugging at times. So yeah, the level design is certainly less tight than the game it's inspired by, and that's not even accounting for its plentiful jank. Take, for instance, this ramp in the Entertainment District. A clever shortcut for those who notice it, right? Well, from most angles, that ramp flies players straight into a building, rather than the parking lot where it was likely aimed. Thus, kind of ruining the whole point of a shortcut. Unfortunately, this is far from the only amateurish mistake, as the whole game is littered with odd design decisions like that. This gap in Springfield Dam is practically impossible to jump from one of the two sides, yet the arrow prompts vehicles to cross it for certain destinations. If the car veers off-road in this portion of Springfield Mountain, it literally gets stuck on the train tracks with no way of getting out besides driving all the way through the tunnel, potentially screwing over an entire run. Moreover, the visuals are bad. The game looks really rough. The inside of Bart's mouth is flesh-colored and it's grossing me out. The collision is also not too great, which seems to be a running theme in these licensed driving games, as one's car can easily flip over when colliding with certain things, and in a game where colliding with things is often encouraged, that becomes a problem. The Z button can reset one's position and location, but just as a general rule, if you need to assign a button to save yourself from shitty collision, you should probably just fix the shitty collision. Even the guidance arrow doesn't always point in the right direction, which is ironic because that's the thing that got this game sued in the first place. Oh yeah, remember the lawsuit thing from 10 minutes ago? In 2003, Sega filed a lawsuit against Fox and EA over patent infringement within the Simpsons Road Rage. Specifically, they cited the 138 patent, which covers certain techniques that Sega used in Crazy Taxi, like pedestrians jumping out of the way from oncoming traffic and the aforementioned arrow that points players where they need to go. Sega and Fox ended up settling things privately, so the full details of the case will never be known, but it's still an interesting situation to examine in retrospect. On one hand, well, yeah, Sega is right, it is a pretty blatant copy, so much so that this lawsuit is fairly expected and to some extent understandable. Sega's a business after all, you gotta protect your IP and stuff, I get it. On the other hand though, I don't know how I feel about the idea of a company claiming ownership over a certain gameplay mechanic, especially with something as simple as an arrow that points where you need to go, as future games would be unable to build upon certain ideas. Even today, games are still using a Crazy Taxi-esque arrow, like Monster Hunter Rise and Mario Golf Super Rush. If this lawsuit had become a bigger thing, it could have prevented these games from featuring these mechanics. Because yeah, Road Rage is not exactly a great package, but it's not exactly harming anything either. It's one of those games that's just kinda there, as it's made somewhat redundant by other releases. Hit and Run does the driving-themed Simpsons game better, and Crazy Taxi does the, well, Crazy Taxi thing better, which basically leaves Road Rage alone in the dust. I will admit though, I do still have some attachment to the game. The level design, visuals, and technical issues certainly leave much to be desired, but the Simpsons references scattered throughout are enjoyable for a fan like me, and a worse version of Crazy Taxi is still Crazy Taxi. That's just an inherently fun style of gameplay. If you don't have the nostalgia, and if you aren't a Simpsons fan, I'd definitely pass on it, but personally, I have a bit of a soft spot for this wacky arcade GameCube title. But what do you think? Have you played Road Rage before? And if so, do you have any thoughts? And while we're on the topic, what is your favorite Simpsons episode as a whole? Comment below with your answers, and don't forget to like and subscribe for future review and video essay content. With that aside, I hope you all have a cromulent day, and I will see you all later.